Okay, I thought I'd do another example. This is a very short solved problem, a Bernoulli equation classic. Here's the problem statement. Liquid water at room temperature, so a density of 998 kilograms per cubic meter, flows at a steady flow rate of 1 liter per second in a tube. The inside diameter of the tube is 3 centimeters at the inlet, so at 1, and 1.6 centimeters at the outlet. The gauge pressure at the inlet is 5.6 kilopascals, and the elevation of the tube decreases by 35 centimeters from the inlet to the outlet. And you're asked to calculate the gauge pressure at the outlet, P2, assuming the flow is one-dimensional and frictionless, so inviscid flow. As I mentioned, this is a Bernoulli equation classic. We're told in the problem statement that the flow is steady and inviscid, so there are no viscous effects. Because the fluid is a liquid, in this case water, the flow will be incompressible. So we can apply Bernoulli's equation from 1 to 2, from the inlet to the outlet. And that's what I've done here. In this form, we have the kinetic energy term, so the kinetic energy per unit mass, the work done by pressure per unit mass, and the gravitational potential energy per unit mass of the flow. So what we're doing in this equation is setting the total energy at the inlet equal to the total energy at the outlet, because there are no losses. So what I've done next is solve for P2, and you should check my algebra here. Now, looking at the right-hand side of this equation, from the problem statement, we know the inlet pressure, P1. We also know the change in elevation of the tube, Z1 minus Z2, which is 35 centimeters. We can also easily calculate the inlet and outlet velocities from the volume flow rate in the tube, which is 1 liter per second. The flow is incompressible, so the volume flow rate Q will be a constant. Here, I've just rewritten our expression for P2 from the previous page. You're told in the problem statement that the volume flow rate is 1 liter per second, but we need that in cubic meters per second. So noting that 1 liter is 10 to the minus 3 cubic meters. So in other words, there's 1,000 liters in a cubic meter. We get that the volume flow rate is Q equals 0.001 cubic meters per second. Here I've used that flow rate to calculate the inlet velocity and the outlet velocity. The inlet velocity V1 is just the volume flow rate divided by the cross-sectional area at the inlet. So the volume flow rate divided by pi D1 squared divided by 4, which gives 1.41 meter per second. And the outlet velocity is the volume flow rate, 0.001 cubic meters per second divided by the cross-sectional area at the outlet, pi d2 squared divided by 4, and that gives almost 5 meters per second. Now we have everything we need to make the substitutions. P1 is 5.6 kilopascals, so that's 5,600 newtons per square meter. Don't forget the 10 to the 3. Next, we have the kinetic energy term. I've just made the substitutions for V1 and V2. Note that the velocity at the outlet is much higher than at the inlet, so the flow has gained kinetic energy, so we expect this term to be negative. The gain in kinetic energy at the outlet will come at the expense of pressure, so this is going to decrease the pressure at the outlet. This is the potential energy term, where the change in height is 0.35 meters. Recall from hydrostatics in chapter 2, as you go deeper in the fluid, the pressure increases, so this term will be positive and act to increase P2. Of course, you should always check that the units balance, as I've done here. So we have kilogram per cubic meter times meter squared per second squared. And here I factored out the kilogram meter per second squared, which is a newton, and we end up with newton per meter squared. Here I've evaluated all the terms. When we add up all the terms, we get that P2 equals minus 2,318 newtons per square meter, or minus 2.3 kilopascals, where the G here is reminding you that it's a gauge pressure. Since P1 is a gauge pressure, P2 will also be a gauge pressure. And that's the final answer. Of course, you should always ask yourself this question: does this value make sense? And can P2 be negative? You might pause the video for a few seconds and think about it before I give the answer. The answer is yes. As I mentioned, the pressure has decreased because the kinetic energy at the outlet has increased. And yes, the outlet pressure can be negative. P2 is a gauge pressure. I purposely showed Borden gauges in the sketch, so both P1 and P2 are relative to the local atmospheric pressure. So P2 can be negative. This is a callback to Chapter 2, where I discussed gauge and absolute pressures. For example, if the local atmospheric pressure was 100 kilopascals, then the absolute pressure at the inlet would be 105.6 kilopascals, and the absolute pressure at the outlet would be 97.7 kilopascals. Again, I've used G and A to indicate gauge and absolute pressures. This is a common nomenclature that you should get used to. I'll end with one last question. Will the actual value of P2 be higher or lower than -2.3 kilopascals? Again, I'll give you a second or two to think about this before I give the answer. The answer is that P2 will be lower than this value because we've neglected viscous losses, so-called pipe friction. There are energy losses in the pipe due to the shear stress at the pipe wall and due to flow turbulence. These are neglected when we use Bernoulli's equation. So the pressure at 2 could be substantially lower than -2.3 kilopascals, for example, if the pipe was very long. You'll learn how to calculate pressure losses in pipes in the next course, Fluids 2, which is MEC 616 at TMU. And that completes this presentation.